See your heart a billion times. In spite of what I see, Lord, I believe. But help my unbelief, I choose to trust you. No matter what I feel, let faith arise.
Good morning, everybody. I'm so glad to see you here this morning. Are you glad to be in God's house today? I'm glad to be anywhere nowadays, right? It's so good to see you. It really is. Thank you for being here at our 9 o'clock service. Today we've got some great things planned for you, and hopefully the Lord will be glorified in all of it. I'd like to ask you to stand, if you will, and we're going to say a word of prayer, and then we're going to begin with some worship. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Lord, now as we sing to you. We thank you so much for the privilege of getting together as a fellowship, not just now, but next hour and then the third hour. Thank you for what you've provided for us. Thank you for the wonderful people that are a part of this fellowship that I love so dearly. Bless us now as we sing, and all God's people say, amen. Please remain standing.
And I will add my welcome to you this morning. And as preach said, the Bible, Psalms 103 does say, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. We're going to sing that song this morning. It's a very simple title, Bless the Lord. So I want you to join in with us today. You can clap your hands. You can act excited. But let's join in together this morning.
Gather in the holy place, bless the Lord. All who call upon the God who saves, bless the Lord. And if your sins have been washed away, bless the Lord. If you stand only by his grace, bless the Lord.
blessing at all times. This morning. Amen. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign.
So bright.
To open up the altars at this time. We're going to be doing this at least until the end of the year, just to ask God to heal our nation, to heal our land, to heal our church, our families, our communities, and maybe you have a specific prayer that you'd like to pray just between you and the Lord. So while the music plays, we're going to open up the altar. Either sit where you're at and pray, or please come. I think it's a good thing for us to come and kneel before the Lord and pray if you're able. So you come ahead and do that as God leads you. Ourselves to you today and always, but today. I thank you for the privilege we have to talk to you. I thank you for the privilege to worship with such great people. Lord, please heal our nation. Lord, please be sovereign in our nation. Forgive us, your people, for sinning, and heal our land. Be our ever-present help in time of need. And all God's people say, amen.
Say of the Lord, you are my shield, my strength, my portion, deliverer, my shelter, strong tower, my very present help. You are my shield, my strength.
Good, was it not? That was a blessing. We're in the book of Numbers, chapter 27, and I want to bring you a message today entitled Leaders' Lives Matter. The growing hatred for all authority that's coming to our land, and encourage you at this point to stand up and do what's right. Leaders' Lives Matter. Now, we've done a good job, I think, of studying the scriptures and connecting Moses in his day to the end times. And so when we look at 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, the Bible says this, "The Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished, but chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government." That's where we're at today. Despise government. Now, this only makes sense because Timothy says in the last days men will be lovers of themselves, and all of that comes with that. But when a person is a lover of themselves, then they make themselves the authority, right? And so if I'm the authority, then I despise all other authorities. And what they will do is then they will despise governments. And man, oh man, are we hearing this. The thing in Beirut, I don't know if you saw the big thing painted on the concrete barrier. My government did this to us in that explosion. So where we are is we are in an era where people despise government. Your translation may say authority. It's the same thing, the government. Now, why that is going on is because God has three institutions for humanity. God designed three institutions to control or lead or encourage humanity. First of all, he created family to bring up children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And is the family under attack today? Yes. He formed the government to be a terror to those who do evil and reward those who are good. Is that being under attack today? Yes. He also created the church to make and train disciples of Jesus Christ. But as I've noted, Satan is against all of these institutions, and he is attacking the family with immorality and divorce. And placing children in a place where it's less likely but not impossible to bring children up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. You watch the news today, you'll understand that there's an attack on governments, not just our government, but all governments, through anarchy. And the anarchists are taking over cities and daring the government to do anything. And here's the thing, the government was created to be a terror to those that do evil. Don't forget that, and to bless those that are good. And then he's also attacking the church through error and persecution. I think the greatest way that the devil attacks the church is to have a person behind a pulpit like this preaching error or doctrine that's close. But I think that the persecution is coming here, if it's not already. Certainly it's been around the world for a long time. It's been interesting to me as we study this pandemic and people are afraid to go to church because they're afraid they might die. And I will remind them that China has been doing that for years. They've been going to church thinking they may die that moment. But here we are in this day and age, and we're walking with people who walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness, and they despise government. Presumptuous are they. They are not afraid to speak evil of dignities. There's just complete anarchy. Peter warned us that this would come. And this is something close to what Moses would have faced and did face as he led the children of Israel. They're not afraid to speak evil of dignities. I want to look at then what is good leadership, because there is a vacuum of good leadership today. Everybody else says, well, we want you to do it. We don't want to be in government. We don't want to be a pastor. We don't want to say anything. We're afraid we may be condemned. We're afraid we may be persecuted. What is good leadership then? Napoleon Bonaparte said it this way, a throne is only a bench covered with velvet, and I say amen to that. There's nothing special about what we do as leaders. It's a hard, hard thing, especially today. Speaking to our young pastors, as I do across this state and across the nation, they ask me, how are you doing? And I say, well, I'm an old man. I've been through a lot. It doesn't matter to me. Kill me. Whatever. Right? But our young people, our young pastors are having a hard time. Lao Tzu says a leader is best when people barely know he exists. When his work is done, his aim will be fulfilled, and they will say, we did it ourselves. I like that. A great leader is best when people barely know he exists. In other words, he doesn't live on Twitter a lot. He doesn't live on CNN a lot. He doesn't live in the media a lot. You just barely know they exist. Get back to my screen here. For some reason, I lost it. There we go. Next, a leader is one who knows the way, goes the way, and shows the way. John Maxwell. And I would say that in our society today that we have a lack of good leadership. And the reason is because leaders are afraid to step forward and say anything that might be posted on Facebook or YouTube. Moses understood that too. Moses exhibited good leadership as he loved the least, loved the lost, and he was the last to leave. He did all three of these things just before he crossed the Jordan. And this is where it's parallel to us today. just before we cross the Jordan, which I think is at any time, before we go to heaven, someone needs to stand up like Moses and do these three things. Today I'd like to cover with you love the least. Now, what I mean by loving the least is not loving the least in quantity. What I mean is loving those who are least, those who are suppressed and those who are crushed. Moses was good at that. I'm not talking about anything other than loving the least. Numbers chapter 27, one day a petition was presented by the daughters of Zelophehad, Mahla, Noah, Hogla, Milcah, and Tirzah. Their father Zelophehad was a descendant of Hepher, the son of Gilead, son of Machir, son of Manasseh, son of Joseph. These women stood before Moses, Eleazar the priest, the tribal leaders, and the entire community at the entrance of the tabernacle. Here's what they said. Verse 3, our father died in the wilderness. They said he was not among Korah's followers who rebelled against the Lord. He died because of his own sin, but he had no sons. Now get the picture here. Moses is handing out property to the tribes. These four girls show up, those who are least. They have no men in their life. They're a part of tribes, but they have no husbands, no dads, no sons, none of that. And they say in verse 4, why should the name of our father disappear from his clan just because he had no sons? Give us property along with the rest of our relatives. So watch this. These least, they're women who are least in this culture for sure, approach Moses and say, look, we are just women, but we need property too. So Moses brought the case before the Lord, and the Lord replied to Moses, listen to this. The claim of the daughters of Zelophehad is legitimate. You must grant them land with their father's relatives. You must do that. And so what Moses did here and what he does here in good leadership is he loved the least. He stood up for those who were least. He stood up for the women in this case that had no property. That's what we're talking about here in loving the least. We're not talking about foolish reparations. This is not a, well, we're sorry that your family has died or been hurt in the past. Let us give you some money. It's also not, my computer's having a hard time today. Sorry about that. See if it'll keep up with me. Greg, will you follow me in Preach's pocket? I appreciate that. It doesn't surprise me that this message would mess up because of what I'm about to say at all. Have you ever noticed when you really hit a hard topic that things like this happen? It does every time. So Greg, you follow me if you will. It's not talking about false repentance. That's not what we're talking about. So loving the least literally means just to restore family rights of real property, of not making foolish reparations and not fake repentance. And in our day, we have groups standing up to make reparations. Now, Black Lives Matters is a group that was formed in 2013 because of the murder of Trayvon Martin. And I don't blame them for standing up for this. Don't blame them at all. But unfortunately, this thing has been such a hot topic that we now have white Hollywood trying to get a piece of it. You got people like this, the Black Lives Matter movement is hotter than any movie star right now. So even when movie stars crave a piece of it, notice in the yellow, they loudly shout about the racial virtue they possess that no one asked them about in the first place. You continue, Florence Pugh of Little Women posted a 1,000-word apology for putting her hair into cornrows when she was 17. To me, this denigrates this whole movement. The Gettysburg Address is only 270 words. But yet white Hollywood wants to get in on the action and say, yeah, we did that and we did that and we're so sorry. Barack Obama used to live in a house, a large white one, that was originally built with slave labor. Did he apologize or marvel at how things have changed for the better? He did not apologize, nor should he. So I wonder then, as we go, are we going to see Johnny Depp beg pardon for wearing cornrows when he played Captain Jack Sparrow? Will Tom Hanks apologize for mocking transgender Americans 40 years ago on Bosom Buddies? Well, maybe Clint Eastwood should say he's sorry for being insensitive to criminals in Dirty Harry. As Clint would say, go ahead and make my day. Now understand that this is not a political denigration to anybody. And understand, because we're mostly white in here, that this is not a condemnation of Black Lives Matter. I don't agree with some of their positions, but we all understand that people of color matter. They're created in the image of God just like we are. And so in 2013, the response to the acquittal of Trayvon Martin's murderer, George Zimmerman, a group formed called Black Lives Matter. And I agree with them that Black Lives Matter 100%. And I do not blame them whatsoever for forming an organization to say enough is enough. On their website, though, we read things like this: we affirm the lives of Black queer and trans folks, disabled folks, undocumented folks, folks with records, women, and all Black lives along the gender spectrum. Our network centers those who have been marginalized with Black liberation movements. I'm okay with that. I'm not okay with what they're supporting, but if they want to do that, that's fine. This is not about that. Also on their website, they say, we are working for a world where Black lives are no longer systematically targeted for demise. Amen to that. The call for Black Lives to Matter is a rallying cry for all Black lives striving for liberation. But is this enough? When they say that they're working for a world where Black lives are no longer systematically targeted for demise, is it just enough to stand up for Trayvon Martin? Is it just enough to stand up for George Floyd? Is that enough? And of course, these events here are horrible and hellish and wrong, and the perpetrator should be persecuted to the full extent of the law. But may I suggest that there's more that we need to be doing? You see, their website says, let's work for a world where Black lives are no longer systematically, and that's the word, systematically targeted for demise. Well, then I would suggest that we begin right here with abortion. With abortion. It's interesting that abortion impacts African Americans at a higher rate than any other population group. At the ratio of 474 abortions per 1,000 live births, Black women have the highest ratio of any group in the country. Do Black lives really matter? White women are 5 times less likely to have an abortion than Black women, and that does not make white people better than Black. Look at all these statements by Walter Blackman. A study protecting Black lives in 2012 found that 79% of Planned Parenthood surgical abortion facilities are located within distance of minority communities. Have you ever noticed that? There's a targeting. There's a targeting of Black people and minorities. Now, that should not surprise you because of the way that Planned Parenthood was founded. If you don't know this, Planned Parenthood was founded by a white supremacist racist, Margaret Sanger. Margaret Sanger says here, and I have all the things on your app to follow up with, like the abortion lobby today, Sanger urged Dr. Gamble to enlist the help of spiritual leaders to justify their deadly work, writing, we do not want the word to get out that we want to exterminate the Negro population. And the minister is the man who can straighten out that idea if it ever occurs to any of their rebellious members. That's what she wanted to do. And if that's what you want to do, then you build your buildings close enough to where they can walk to get the care they want. That is straight from hell. She goes on to say also, Margaret said, and this is interesting, finally, Planned Parenthood has devoured her racist legacy but continues to carry out the work. Margaret Sanger gets canceled. Margaret Sanger, the Wall Street Journal says, has been morally promoted to the rank of Confederate General. It comes courtesy of Planned Parenthood of Greater New York, which will remove Sanger's name from its Manhattan clinic because of her racist legacy and deep belief in eugenic ideology can no longer be denied. This is Planned Parenthood admitting she's a white racist and she started Planned Parenthood to eliminate that race. You can't make this stuff up. Walter Blackman goes on to say this: according to the Guttmacher Institute, which generally supports abortion, in 2011, 360 black babies were aborted. CDC statistics for 2011 show that 287,072 black deaths occurred from all other causes excluding abortion. Watch this. By these numbers, abortion is the leading cause of death among blacks. We're not off the hook either, us white folk. Abortion is the number one killer of black lives in the United States. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, abortion kills more black people than HIV, homicide, diabetes, accident, cancer, and heart disease combined. Then why in God's name are we despising government? When they're not the real enemy. Why would we do that? Why aren't we going against the number one killer of black lives? Why doesn't Black Lives Matter stand up against them? Why are we in the place where we despise government? Is it then right? Is what we need to do then to defund the police? As horrible and as rotten and terrible and racist and every other word that's negative, what happened to George Floyd with that police officer appears in the video to be nothing but murder. I get it. Now, I'm the first guy to stand up and stand up for the police being a police chaplain, but some of these guys will do things outside of their training. I understand that. But is it enough to just defund the police when 1,000 black babies are killed every day? Why isn't anybody going after that? Out of the 44 million babies that have been born since 1973, 19 million of them had African American descent. So is it, what, do we need to defund the police, or should we remove Confederate statues? Is that going to help us? It's not going to save any babies' lives. I say we defund abortion clinics. Let's defund that. Let's go out after the source of the target. If black lives really matter, and white lives really matter, and babies' lives don't matter, apparently, and Hispanic babies' lives matter, then why don't we go to the person who's killing more than 600,000 of them a year? No one wants to stand up and say that. No politician wants to say that. No politician wants to talk out one side of their mouth and say, people's lives matter, and then kill 600,000 to a million a year. No one wants to say defund abortion clinics. No one wants to say that that's where the real issue is. That's where all the murder is taking place. That's where all the destruction is taking place. That's just what needs to stop. See, that's what Moses did when he stood up for those four girls. He says, you are the least ones, and I'm going to speak up for you and protect you. Proverbs chapter 31, verses 8 and 9, look at this. Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. Ensure justice for those who are being crushed. Christians, that's what we should be doing. And I'm pleading with you, and I think God's word is pleading with you, somebody needs to stand up and be a leader in this area. Somebody needs to stand up and say, I will love the least. I will protect those who cannot speak for themselves. I will protect those that are being crushed, regardless of skin color, because we're all created in the image of God. Yes, speak up for the poor and helpless, and see that they get justice. Think about what I've just said for a little bit. All hell breaks loose when one cop is bad. And it should. Nothing is said day after day after day after day after day after day after day where roughly 3,000, 2,500 babies are murdered, 1,000 of them of African American descent, and nobody says a thing. And as a matter of fact, as I understand it, I didn't see this in the news, but Doc Dameron said that there were two people arrested for riding on a sidewalk in front of an abortion clinic. All lives matter, Doc? Was that what they said? Unborn black lives matter, and they were arrested. Now, this is not about black and white, red and yellow, black and white. We're all precious inside. It's not about that. Somebody needs to stand up and say, enough oppressing those that have no voice. And that's not just me, that's you. That's you taking a stand and saying, this is murder. That's exactly what it is. And they need justice. See, Moses was a good leader because he loved the least one. He loved that one who couldn't speak up for themselves. He loved those girls that had no one to come and petition him. And God backed him up on this. He says, listen, these girls have a legitimate complaint. You take care of them. And I think that God would say that to us right before we cross the Jordan. I think all of this is interesting that these things happen just before Moses went in or was going to go into the promised land but was kept out. He loved the least, he loved the lost, and he was the last to leave. We'll cover the next two next week. Let's bow our heads for prayer. My Heavenly Father, I love you and I thank you for the privilege we have of being in your house today. And this is just a lot of information to absorb. And rioting in the streets is just not enough. Change has to happen. And it has to happen across the board. We are a nation who is killing its own citizens. We are killing the next presidents. We are killing the next MLKs. We are killing the next George Washington Carvers. We're killing the next George Bushes. We're killing those who will potentially lead us in the future, and we kill them as if their life has no meaning. God, forgive us as a nation. I, for one, will stand up and speak for those who have no voice. But beyond that, we have to do something about it. God, we live in a mad, mad world today that doesn't make sense. We strain at a gnat and we swallow a camel. We love riots, but you can't go to church. We can paint Black Lives Matter on streets, but we do chalk art where it says Black Babies Lives Matter and we're arrested. We are people who oppose themselves. We must stand up and do what's right. God, heal our land. Remove all this racial tension because we understand that you created us all in the image of God. The gospel of Christ stands and says all men are equal. All men are equally loved. All men have equal value and equal worth. We do not need to kneel to any protests. We stand with the gospel of Christ. I ask your blessing in your name. Amen. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I think what God's word would say to us right before we cross the Jordan, as it were, that leaders' lives matter. We need people to stand up like yourself and say, look, enough is enough. Enough is enough. Let's speak the truth of the word of God to a nation that needs the word of God. Amen. And I don't know how God has spoken to your heart this morning. This is a much different kind of a message. But I want to encourage you to stiffen your back and to stand up and speak for those that have no voice and those who are being crushed. Stand up for that, but do it in a right way. Let's go for the real target. Let's not save with one hand and kill with the other. So now the altars will be open again. I'm going to invite you to come and pray if you need to. And if you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior, then you need to save your own life. You need to save your own life and escape what's coming on the earth. As the music plays, I'm going to invite you to stand, if you will, as we go into invitation. Please stand. Lord, we love you and we thank you for the time we've had in your house today. And as we now go to our life groups, I pray that you'll bless us as we fellowship. And all God's people say, amen. This hour, we have all of our life groups available today, so please stay for that. And they're in the same place they were last week. Some of them are going to split after initially meeting because they were so large. But God bless you and thank you for being here today. Brenda and I will be at the Connection Center. If you're a guest here today, please stop by and see us. Other than that, love you. Glad to be here. Amen. It's good to see you.